From the St. Francis Yacht Club in San Francisco, this is the Wednesday Yachting Luncheon, hosted by Ron Young.
Welcome to the Wednesday Yachting Luncheon, live from the virtual grill room of the St. Francis Yacht Club. We hope that you and yours are sheltering in place in a comfortable environment, and we welcome you back into our grill room just as soon as conditions permit. Our speaker today has been in the news quite a bit in the last couple of years. First, as the very well-regarded coach of the Stanford sailing team, a position that he held with great honor and served well for many years. In fact, the most recent Collegian Sailors of the Year were young sailors that our speaker today coached.
To the continuing fallout from the college cheating scandal known as Operation Varsity Blues. Former Stanford University sailing coach John Vandemoer was the first defendant to be sentenced in the scandal that's ensnared dozens of wealthy families, including Full House actress Lori Loughlin and her husband, and actress Felicity Huffman. Vandemoer documents his experiences in his new book, Rigged Justice, How the College Admissions Scandal Ruined an Innocent Man's Life.
Welcome, John Vandemoer, to the Wednesday Yachting Luncheon. Wonderful to have you here, John.
Thank you for having me.
So now, first of all, we're talking to you from the Wednesday Yachting Luncheon format, and behind you, I see that we're in a working guy's garage. This is a guy who could put a mast in, take a mast down. It looks to me like you could fix electrical systems too, John. Where are you where we're speaking to you now?
This is my garage in Half Moon Bay, and part of my new career working as an engineer. I do a lot of tinkering in this garage.
We all know that we owe a great debt to the engineers. So, John, tell me, by way of background, how did your sailing career start? And specifically, what was the first boat you could ever remember being in? What age were you and where were you?
6, 7 years old, growing up in Cape Cod, Massachusetts. And my first boat was a 1920s era Beetle Cat, all wooden boat. That my father and I barely put together in my garage. And that was our winter project. And my reward in the summers was to go sailing.
I know what a Beetle Cat is because I've sailed in them. Talk to people about the dimensions of a Beetle Cat.
Beetle Cat's a little over 13 feet long, I guess closer to 14 feet. It is one sail, one gaff rigged mainsail. Wooden classic boat, invented in the 1920s in the New England area in Concordia Yachts. And it's still a classic boat. They still have what's the world championships, or as I call them, the intergalactics, or the Talismanic Trophy, the Leo Talismanic Trophy every year on Cape Cod. And it's still a big following. They get like 30, 40 boats out. It's great.
So how did you get this boat? How did this boat come to your family?
It was a neighbor of ours had the boat that was on a trailer that was part of a brush fire that happened. And so my dad was a collector of all things in brush fires. So we went out and grabbed it and rebuilt the boat, rebuilt the trailer. And there we were. That was my first boat.
That's great. And so give me 5 steps from there to you becoming the head sailing coach of the prestigious Stanford sailing team.
I mean, I was very fortunate to grow up on Cape Cod and got to sail through Highness Yacht Club. Eventually went to high school at St. George's School in Newport, Rhode Island, and got to do lots of sailing in Newport and grew up there. Did a healthy bit of college sailing at Hobart and William Smith Colleges in New York. And then from there, I got a science degree and had a science background, but decided that working in a lab at Merck Pharmaceuticals wasn't for me. And so I started as one of the coaches at Chicago Yacht Club and moved to Chicago, a place I'd never been before, and started running the sailing program there. Eventually, after about 5 years of doing youth sailing, I moved on to collegiate sailing at St. Mary's College and was the assistant coach there, and eventually got moved to the US Naval Academy and became the head coach there. I was the assistant coach and then the head coach at the US Naval Academy. For a few years, and then came out to Stanford for this job.
And so what year was that?
I came to Stanford in the fall of 2008. Uh-huh.
And so in the time that you were the head coach of the Stanford sailing team, tell us your record for what year to what year.
So from 2008 till the early spring of 2019, the team won almost every conference championship in the PCCSC. We were undefeated in team racing for 11 years, We had a few years that we never lost a race in our conference for team racing. We were able to make the national championship podium many times. The Fowl Trophy, which is for the overall number one college sailing team. So that's all six national championships tallied together. So single-handed men's and women's, match racing, team racing, co-ed fleet racing, women's fleet racing, all those together makes the top college sailing team. We were in the top five, seven of my 11 years there, and had numerous All-Americans, over 30 All-Americans, over 30 academic All-Americans, three Olympians, and had a Marshall Scholar as well.
What's a Marshall Scholar? Tell our audience.
So Marshall Scholar is an academic scholarship for academic excellence, an all-around academic excellence. And I believe I forgot what the total number is, but it's a small number of scholars from around the world that could get it.
What's the job of the head sailing coach at Stanford? What are your hours like? Where's your office? Where do you spend your time? How much time on the water? Give us a kind of a year in the life of a Stanford sailing coach.
Yeah, so in season is different than out of season, but in season, so for college sailing, that's the spring and the fall seasons. Spring season starts, well, for us on the West Coast, it starts about February, end of January, beginning of February. Everybody else, it's a little bit later than that. We have nicer weather. And then that goes till June. The beginning of June is the national championships when it ends. And then the fall season starts beginning of September, September 1 to Thanksgiving, essentially. And in those times, we at Stanford, I was traveling almost every weekend, almost exclusively to the East Coast. The majority of the college regattas are on the East Coast. So we had one part of the team, women's team racing, co-ed, match racing, so on, going to the East Coast every weekend. And so I would travel primarily with them, did all the travel planning. I was a glorified travel agent doing that. Learned a lot about travel through that time. And then did all the recruiting, did all the fundraising for the team, all the budgeting as well as putting together practice every day and kind of our overseason and over year plan of what we're going to do for our student athletes and how to kind of plan all that out.
What's a typical day in the life for a sailing student? They get out of class at 4 or what happens? Tell us what a typical sailor will spend time sailing.
Yeah, so a normal day, and this is a great question. So a normal day for a college sailor is getting up at about 6 a.m., going to the gym for a workout session, team breakfast, usually together after that, then going to school. Usually the way our class periods worked that they would go to school till about 2:30, and then we would go down to the boathouse at 2:30, have a practice till about 6 or so. And then they would go back to campus and either start doing work right away, or they would have sometimes evening classes as well. 7 o'clock was the next class, I believe, for that.
So they get on the water at what time? And they get off the water at what time?
It's usually practice is about 3 to 6.
Mm-hmm. On the water.
Yeah.
And describe the boats for the average person who's watching that they're sailing.
So the majority of college sailing is done in double-handed boats, and it's really two boats that dominate college sailing. It is the 420. The 420, we have the Club 420 U sailing that you might see a lot. I know St. Francis has a bunch of Club 420s. It's a version of that 420, the collegiate style. And then the FJ, which also St. Francis has, with most of the high school sailing is done out of, is that kind of a version of that FJ as well. Mm-hmm. So they're both like 13-foot boats.
How many students are on the team?
The typical team would be about 22 to 26 players each year.
Mm-hmm. And what's the average age or median age?
The median age is 20, I would say, 20, 21.
What's the male-female mix?
At Stanford, it was always heavily female. So it was about 70%, 65 to 70% female every year I was there.
So how much sailing experience has the average person on the team had?
So at Stanford, we would have a wide range. So you would have a sailor who had been to Youth Worlds or Sailing World Championships in a class and had lots of experience, to a sailor that just sailed at their club, maybe year-round, maybe just in the summers, to athletes that were walk-ons that had basically no sailing experience or did it at a camp one time. But they were athletes in other sports and had a lot of athletic ability to contribute.
What's the GPA level like of collegiate sailors compared, say, to like soccer or football?
Yeah, at Stanford, I don't have the direct comparison to the other sports, but the comparison I have to the student body is that the sailing team GPA average was always higher than the average GPA at Stanford of a non-student athlete. So really high.
Give me some numbers. What kind of a GPA we're talking about?
So an average GPA for the sailing team would be around 3.3 to 3.4 GPA. We had students that were repeatedly in the 4.0 range. We've had two students that won the highest GPA at the school twice for that, and the highest GPA in engineering as well.
Mm-hmm. What are the majors like of the 20 folks that are on the sailing team?
It really goes in fits and spurts. It's pretty interesting. There would be years that everybody would be just straight engineering, you know, mechanical, electrical engineering. That's where they wanted to be. Some years it would go to more of the management science side. When I left Stanford, it was more of the product design degree was really popular. Architecture was becoming more popular as well. But really, it's been heavily in the engineering and heavy in the sciences.
What percent of the students who sail go on to get advanced degrees?
I don't know if I have the number off my head, but off the top of my head, I would say it's over 60%.
Go get a master's or something beyond.
Yes. Yeah.
Give us the training cycle for a typical sailor in season. Like you said earlier, so how much time are they spending in a physical workout, et cetera? How much time are they spending in classroom? Give me the way you spend your time with them.
Yeah, so in college sailing, they have rules governing this. And so a collegiate athlete, a sailing collegiate athlete, could only spend 20 hours a week on their sport. And so that included some travel, but included any time that coaches were mandating anything, really. So team meetings to workouts to video work to on the water coaching, that was all required, and regatta time. So an average sailor in college is doing pretty close to those 20 hours a week, especially if you really count in the competition. All competition in college sailing is two days, really. It's all day Saturday, all day Sunday. So that takes a majority of the practice time. But a normal college sailor would, you know, a normal college sailor at Stanford would have morning workouts twice a week that they would go to. They would have one day a week that we would do video and kind of chalk talk type stuff on campus. We had the unique situation that our boathouse was not on campus, so traveling took up a lot of time. So we tried to limit that as much as we could. And so we do one day a week kind of on campus looking at video, going through venue reports, going through stuff that we saw from the previous weekend and so on. And then we'd have on the water time 2 to 3 days a week of practice, and one day really fully of traveling to the East Coast. So Fridays were usually travel days.
Travel on Friday and come back to school Sunday night or when?
Yeah, come back Sunday night. Yep.
And so they'd fly to Connecticut or Newport or wherever the regatta was going to be.
Exactly. Yep.
Okay. And how many schools and who describe the conference?
So the Pacific Coast Conference was... it's kind of your typical Pac-12 schools, except for the northern schools. The Northwest is a separate conference. So we would have Cal Maritime, Hawaii was in our conference, UCSB, USC, UC San Diego, all those teams. Arizona, the Arizona schools were in our conference as well. And so that was the, you know, West Coast Conference or Pacific Coast Conference.
And talk about the staff of the sailing program at Stanford. You're the head of it. What other staff do you have available?
So for majority of my time there at Stanford, it was myself and one other coach. I was really lucky to have Clinton Hayes was my co-coach with me for 8 years, which was incredible. And so the two of us were together for most of it. For three of the years, we fundraised enough to add a third coach. And so we had Atlantic Brugman, who did a 470 campaign. She was fantastic, and she did 2 years with us. So we had three coaches that year. And then we had 1 year with Belle Strawn, my last year in 2019, that she did a year with us as well.
And what's the annual budget, and how did it gradually change?
So the school gave us a budget, you know, placeholder number about $240,000 a year. to cover all of our travel expenses. Expenses, our gas expenses were pretty high because we had to drive to and from the boathouse every year, every day. So that was expensive. All of our uniform expenses were put into that. Travel, food, all that stuff was there. And it so did not cover any of our boats or capital expenses.
That's a separate budget.
The separate budget.
The capital expense that the school handles.
Right. So the capital expenses the school didn't provide, we would have to fundraise for that.
Okay. So on the subject of boats you use, when do you bring boats and when do you use host school boats?
So we use the host school boats whenever we travel out of conference, in particular to the East Coast. The host team would supply 18 even boats that we would rotate through. On the West Coast, for most West Coast events, or really the Pacific Coast events, we would trailer boats to those events.
Now let's talk about how you get students to join the sailing club. How many just come organically and how many do you invite?
I guess I would say it a different way. I would say how many are walk-ons and how many are recruited. Recruited really is a loose term. It means that they reached out to me and I talked to them and maybe I gave them the support with admissions, maybe I didn't. And then walk-on means that they got into the school. After they got into Stanford, they decided they wanted to try out for the sailing team. On the walk-on range, we would average about 1 to 2 a year. I would say closer to 1 a year. That would be walk-on. Most everybody at least was in contact with me before they enrolled in Stanford that the sailing was something that they wanted to do or they wanted to be recruited to with help with admissions to get into Stanford.
Mm-hmm. And so now you recruit students too. You go hunt for good sailors. Yeah. Tell us about your recruiting activities. How do you do that?
So really two ways. One is shamelessly stalk them through the internet and look at, you know, results from all over the world, especially when you have international students, which Stanford definitely attracted international students. And then going to as many events as you could. My other job while I was at Stanford as well was I was the executive director of the Club 420 class. And so I was running Club 420 events all summer. And that gave me a front row seat to see a lot of sailors. But there were still a lot of sailors that you just wouldn't be able to see. We didn't have, you know, the recruiting budgets of a basketball or a football are phenomenal. I mean, those coaches, when they don't have a game that week, they're all on the road recruiting nonstop. And we don't have budgets to be able to do that. My recruiting budget's pretty small. So it was a lot of talking to other coaches.
What is your recruiting budget?
Our recruiting budget every year was about $5,000 to $6,000. And really, it supported us to do a couple things. One was to go to Orange Bowl every year and go to the Orange Bowl talk at the Orange Bowl youth event. And that gobbled up a lot of it. Going to Miami at Christmas time was not cheap. And then we used it to go to one other event. We'd pick one other event a year to go to. Sometimes it'd be Rose Bowl down at USC. Sometimes it'd be another event. If we knew that there was another big event, like a North American Championship or something that year, we would try to send either Clinton or myself to that event.
Tell me, when you go to such an event, what's your day like? How do you spend your time?
It's honestly pretty awkward because you show up and I do my best to set up meetings with sailors because you have to be respectful that they're trying to work hard for a championship or whatever event that they're doing, or it's a qualifier. And you can't really impede on their personal space to do that. That certainly doesn't put you off on a good foot. So I try to schedule some things either right before or right after the event, mainly before. And then it's also like an Orange Bowl example, they have a huge college sailing night every year. And so being a participant in that, again, that is, it's kind of a crazy time to be able to be there and talk to all these students there. And it's very general. So any of the students I was really recruiting, I was trying to set up specific meetings, you know, off to the side and so on to talk to them.
We're all familiar with the football Orange Bowl.
Yeah, it's pretty close in time. Actually, in one year when Stanford qualified for the Orange Bowl and won the Orange Bowl under Harbaugh those days, I actually got to put those trips together. But no, they're not usually at the same exact time. There's an Orange Bowl International Regatta, which is an offshoot of the Orange Bowl football event every year. And it's an international Orange Bowl. So the only longstanding international youth event that happens in the U.S. every year. And it gets a great attendance from really all over the world.
What number of kids get a sailing scholarship at Stanford?
Zero. There is no such thing as scholarships.
So no kid gets a sailing scholarship at Stanford?
No. So
what do you do for a sailor who decides that they want to join the sailing team?
Yeah, so to be clear for that, in college sailing, the only recruiting rule there is in college sailing is that there is no money for scholarships. And so it's banned in that. So that's the one thing that we cannot do. For a college sailor that where I'm recruiting, so really I'm going through the full recruiting process, the same as a national letter of intent for a soccer player or a football player or anything else, except for they're getting a scholarship at the other end of it. We're just giving them support through admissions, telling admissions, hey, we would really like the student athlete to come to Stanford and be part of our community.
And so how many kids will you look at in recruiting in a given year?
So I would be in contact each year with about around 100 students a year. And so I would say, I would put it this way, it overlaps two classes. So about 100 juniors every year and about 25 seniors every year that I was working with. Because those two classes kind of overlap in the recruiting process. Mm-hmm. And so those are the ones I would actively be working with. And as my recruiting year went through, obviously those numbers are whittling down.
Your target, your bogey is 20 students to go into the next academic year, correct?
I wish. So for my recruiting spots, I averaged about 6 recruiting spots a year. So that means 6 students that I could present to admissions and say, hey, these students are students that could really help the team and that we want to support through the admission process.
Meaning enable them to come to the school, not give them any money, not give them any expense money, but just approve their admission to the school.
Correct. Yes. And ultimately, admissions would make that decision whether they could be admitted to the school or not. They would still have to meet all the academic rigor. I like to describe it as, say, Ron, you were applying to Stanford and you had a twin and you sailed, but your twin didn't. And I went to bat for you as the sailor, but everything else, all your academics are the same. We would probably most likely break the tie for you to get into Stanford, but your twin wouldn't.
Okay. And so give us essentially the sort of like entering GPAs of kids that you select.
A normal student getting into Stanford that I would recruit through the sailing program has pretty close, well, has one of two things. They're either really close to perfect test scores, either ACT or SAT. We're talking 99th percentile for those scores. Or they have grades that are, you know, the top of their class. So their GPAs could be different because comparing GPAs from school to school is hard with the course offerings that they have. But a typical Stanford student would be taking the most challenging or one of the most challenging academic loads at their high school and getting pretty close to straight A's in that, maybe a few B's. A student at Stanford would be most likely doing better in the classroom than necessarily having the best test scores. The test scores are weighted less than I would say the course load and how successful they are in that course load.
And how many of the sailors joining that you pick, are they going to be freshmen versus sophomores, juniors, et cetera?
I would say the vast majority are freshmen. We do get walk-ons that are sophomores. I even had a walk-on senior once, and she was fantastic. She was a gymnast, was recruited to Stanford as a gymnast, and then through injuries just couldn't do gymnastics anymore. And started a national championship for us that spring because she was so athletic. She was amazing. So there's usually very few walk-ons throughout the year. It's usually all freshmen.
What if their parents make a donation to the school? How does that affect the decision to admit them to school?
So that comes to the crux of my story, that I asked that very question to my athletic director, who at the time was in charge of development, so fundraising for the athletic department. And so I had a student who was actually now famous in the New York Times, a woman named Molly Zhao, who a third party, Rick Singer, came up to me and said, look, I have this sailor. I have the student who's a sailor from Hong Kong, but she's doing boarding school in the UK. And she has these laser results, which were okay, they were decent laser results. Would you be interested in supporting her? And at the time, I had actually recruited another laser sailor who ultimately went on to win the single-handed national championships in college for Stanford. And so I was not in the market for another laser sailor. So I said, no problem. And so Rick said, well, she comes from an affluent family. And this family would be willing to donate if she got into Stanford. In fact, be willing to donate $1 million to the Stanford sailing program if she got into Stanford. Is that something that you could, would that help? Could you help that? And I told Rick that I honestly didn't know. I was baffled. This is the first time anybody's ever raised that with me. And so I went when I thought was the best thing to do was went to my boss and asked and said, look, here's the situation. We have the sailor from affluent family that wants to donate $1 million if she gets into Stanford and or is interested in donating. And my boss's response was kind of the same as mine, baffled, didn't know, and said she would ask as well. And so she went to her superiors, or I assume she went to her superiors in development in Stanford, and she gave me a phone call back and said, look, that is something that Stanford does, but $1 million isn't enough to support with admissions. And I dropped my jaw on the floor and was shocked by it, but I didn't feel good about the whole situation anyway. So I said, okay, great. I did what I thought I could do. It would have been fantastic to have $1 million donated to the sailing program. We could do a lot with that. But I just said, look, okay, that's it. And so I dropped it. My athletic director came back about, I would say, a few weeks later and said that, hey, there's no spot for Molly Zhao. I'm not using a spot for her at all, but we would be glad to put her on a development watch list, which I had never heard of before either. And said, hey, we're going to put her on the development watch list and we'll see what happens. And I said, great, sounds great. Thanks for following up. I appreciated her time for that. And I told Rick that that was it.
When you say her time, you mean your director, your boss's time?
Yeah, the athletic director in charge of my sport. Yeah.
Okay. The athletic director. Okay.
Yeah. And who happened to be in charge of development. So she was the perfect person to go to ask this type of question because I want to make sure that I'm doing my job. So then nothing came of it until right before school started that coming fall. And I got a call from Rick Singer. And Rick said, hey, John, and I hadn't heard from him at all through the whole summer, through the whole spring. And he said, oh, we're so excited that Molly's going to Stanford. I was like, oh, wow, she got in. That's great. I had no idea that she had gotten into Stanford. And he's like, yeah, it's, she's really excited. It was between her. It was between Stanford and Harvard. And so what she wants to do, her family wants to do is because both schools are really tight, they want to donate $500,000 to Harvard and $500,000 to the Stanford sailing team. And I said, wow, well, is she going to sail on the sailing team? No, I think she's going to take a year to, get used to the academics and then maybe she'd join after that. That response is actually fairly typical. There's a lot of students that I talk with a lot, but I don't end up helping with admissions. And then they get into Stanford and they say, well, we're going to see how school goes and my academic rigor goes before I commit to a team. So I said, okay, no problem. That wasn't shocking to me at all. But the $500,000 was really shocking. And I went down and told that same boss, that same athletic director that's in charge of development and said, hi, so this guy, Rick Singer, wants to donate $500,000 from this family that I did nothing for. She got in on her own. And he wants to donate it through his foundation, the now kind of famous foundation for Rick Singer. And she said, great, this is how to do it. And bring the check right here. And so that's exactly what I did. The check arrived in the mail a week later, and I went down and handed it off to my boss, who was there with the athletic director, Bernard Muir, at the time, and handed the check over to my athletic director. And Bernard turned over and said, oh, congratulations. This is great. Shook my hand. And I started to explain how I got the check through this guy, Rick Singer. And he turned to me and said, oh, we know Rick. That's great. Good job. And he walked off. So I thought I did a really good job. Here I did nothing. And, I got a $500,000 donation, the largest donation I've ever gotten at any school. And it had a huge impact for our team It supplied boats. It supplied new vehicles for us to go back and forth from campus to the sailing center. It was a big impact for us. And so that's the first time I've heard of money having an influence on admissions.
And the student in question here, she didn't come sailing?
She never did. No, I never heard from her when she enrolled at Stanford.
Did you meet her?
Never did. No.
Didn't meet her?
No.
Okay, so now let's take this story forward just a little bit more. So there you are going about your business, thinking about what you can do to get a national champion going. You got a couple of students that are looking better and better and better. And then what kind of phone call do you get? Or what notice do you know that all of a sudden somebody's looking at this whole game of college scholarships?
You know, looking back at it, you can kind of see how the steps were taken from Rick Singer to kind of keep working me in. As my lawyer put it, he was grooming me, and he did steps to groom me into the situation. And I certainly let him groom me at times too. But really what happened is right after that $500,000 check from Molly Zhao and through his foundation, then there was an increase in contact from Rick Singer to me. Really before that $500,000 check, there was maybe two emails and two phone calls. You know, I described the entirety of our relationship so far. And then it became increasing.
What would an email say?
Really just following up and making sure that I was asking about Molly Zhao and whether the money had any influence in helping her get admission to Stanford. They were really just follow up for it.
What was the admission process for her? What happened?
So I don't know, because I didn't have any role in it. As soon as I passed it off and they said they put her on the development watch list, I assumed that she got in on her own through her academics. Later, she was, after all this came out, she was expelled from school because apparently she lied on her application. But I never saw her application or anything. I never even met her.
So you, to this minute, haven't met this person?
No. No, never have. Never talked to her.
Okay.
Or her family.
Right. So when you say he was grooming you, talk to me about step one, step two, step three, et cetera.
Yeah. So it really started with our first interaction when he first introduced Molly Zhao, because he did three things that really, you know, embedded himself in with me. One is that he came to visit me in person and really did his research on me, on the team, and was really there to kind of listen to me. He was very easy to talk to, very charismatic, and he was a guy you could talk to for days. You know, a guy you would have a beer with and talk about sports. You know, he was that type of guy and had a lot of knowledge on sports, but was totally admitting that he knew nothing about sailing. So he became really vulnerable himself and really wanted to hear from me, an expert, on what a college sailor looked like. He was really interested in developing a college sailing recruitment program and being able to do that. He had done that for basketball and tennis and other sports, but was interested in sailing. The other thing that happened is that he pointed me towards, or had other coaches, or had another coach reach out to me and kind of vouch for him. In this case, it was the associate head basketball coach for men's basketball at Stanford, Adam Cohen, and had him reach out to me through voicemails and emails saying that, hey, this is a good person to work with. Our program works with him. This is someone for you to be in touch with. And then the last thing was that the athletic directors, both the athletic director that I worked with and the head athletic director, Bernard Muir, said that they knew him and congratulated me for working with him. So there, this whole environment was built for me to kind of be sucked in with him into it. And it made it really hard for me to see what was happening overall. And so he continued to play off that. He got a perfect time for me because it was a time in my life and coaching that I was thinking a lot about what I was doing as a college coach. I had kind of hit a barrier that I wasn't breaking through. I wanted to win more national championships and we weren't. We had great recruiting classes, but somehow our team chemistry wasn't great. And so I was really trying to find new ways to do that. And he caught up or caught on to that and really worked that. I was looking for students to come in. I had no problem recruiting top level sailing recruits. They're still there. They're still doing fabulously well. They're doing great. And they're great student athletes and great people. But what I was struggling with is all the role players. How do you get role players to come in to get beat up at practice every day? And those players are essential to be able to make your team grow. You know, that training partner is so important to be able to make your program grow. And the relationship of your training partner to your starters is even more important. That has to be a really cohesive relationship to bring the team forward and keep that, that culture, that team culture moving forward. And we had been failing at that. I had been failing at that as a leader. And Rick was here to say, hey, I've got these students who are great at other sports, who are, you know, two true team players. And will you consider them as people to come on the team? And that piqued my interest. I had mentioned before, we had the senior walk-on who was a gymnast. And she was not only a phenomenal athlete and was able to start at a national championship in her first year because she was so athletic, but she got how to be part of a team. And sailors through high school sailing and youth sailing aren't really getting that exposure. They're not getting, they don't have to sit on the bench, right, as much. At a youth sailing event, you sign up, you pay your entry fee, you go sailing. There's none of, you have to sit on a bench and wait for someone else to get the role over you. And you have to work really hard to earn that role. That doesn't happen in youth sailing really nearly as much as it probably should. And so when they get to the collegiate level, it's hard for them to take it. Well, we've always been able to go to the regatta that we wanted to. Why does this matter? And so finding other students were there, and Rick really tacked into that. So he brought me students that had some sailing background. Some were very little sailing background, but had lots of other sports. Some had kind of mediocre background, but really wanted to go and be part of the team. And so those two students are the two students that I was ultimately charged with supporting. And, you know, as I'll tell you my story, I actually never even really supported them. But they were two students that I were interested in, and that's why.
So what's the duration of your relationship when you first met Rick? What year was that, and when was the last time you saw him?
So I first met Rick in 2016. And really the relationship ended in the fall of 2018. So he introduced me to Molly Zhao in the beginning of 2016 to 17, and then in the fall of 2018 is when the case started being broken open.
Okay. And so how many, during that period of time, year and a half or so, how many students or candidates would he bring to you to pitch to put on the sailing team?
He brought me two more students besides the Molly who we talked about. So two more
total
students.
Of three total.
Total of three. Yep.
Okay. And in each case, what's his business model? How does he get motivated to do this?
So he introduced it in two ways. One is that his main business was recruiting for basketball and other bigger sports. And that's where he was making his money. But he was also interested in working with affluent families to be able to help them get into schools, you know, as a consultant. And so he was helping them with their applications, with making introductions, being a third-party recruiter, which is pretty common in other sports. This is the first time I ever heard about it in sailing.
And so when he would put a person in, if he got somebody to put $500,000 in the Stanford program, how much would he get paid to do that?
So I had no idea. And so that part was completely hidden to me. So from what I learned well after the fact, well after I was even charged with this, is that I believe, I'm knowing this from the New York Times, but I believe that Molly Zhao's family gave him $6.5 million and he donated $500,000. So it was a pretty good profit margin for him to collect that $6 million in there. So he was doing quite well with that model. But you could tell as the case broke open and we learned more about his interaction with all these parents that the number amounts were not consistent. They were all over the place. So he had different deals with different parents and was certainly trying to push where he could push. But I think he also recognized where he couldn't push that hard.
And so how many students a year do you think he is getting into schools?
From what I know now, I think overall, it's probably almost 100 students a year.
he is essentially going to make $6 million or $5 million on a student. That's probably a high number. What do you think the average was?
I think it was a high number. I think from what we know now, he's probably making, you know, let's say he's averaging about $15,000 to $20,000 a student.
Real small, not $6 million like this one student.
Zounds. Right. I think those numbers had really changed a lot. They really fluctuated. They make $1 million or $2 million on one student and then make, $10,000, $20,000 on another student.
Uh-huh. Were there certain nationalities that he was more prone to be recruiting?
It certainly was, from what I know, mainly U.S. So it was mainly U.S., mainly California students that he was looking at.
Were they more Asian or not Asian or anything nationality-wise?
I don't know. I've seen, from what I've known from the stories, that it's kind of a mix. Not one particular race, I'd say.
Okay. So the other two students that he suggested to you, what was your sailing credentials like?
So one of them had kind of mediocre sailing. High school sailing, was involved with high school sailing, was involved with some other youth sailing. Not wildly successful, but the resume made it seem like they were coming to practice every day and kind of, a team player type person. And the other one was someone who had a little bit of a sailing experience, but mainly was actually in gymnastics. And that was their big key sport, and something that they, would be able to take to the sailing team.
And so did either of those other two become part of the sailing team?
They never even applied to Stanford.
Okay. So now here you are, going about your business. You've got two young kids. I know, cause I've been to your home. You have a wonderful wife, Molly, who, as you and I both know, brilliant, great young sailor. And you get a knock on the door. Talk about what happens here.
Yeah. So one morning in February of 2019, I got a knock on the door about 7 a.m. At the time, we had a 3- and a 1-year-old. And so we were in the thick of it, trying to get out the door, trying to get them to daycare. Molly was getting ready to go to work at PYSF, the Peninsula Youth Sailing Foundation in Redwood City. And I was getting ready to try to go to work at Stanford. And we were covered in whatever we tried to serve for breakfast that morning. I know the families out there will understand this. I was in, pajama bottoms and a Red Sox t-shirt, covered in yogurt. Goat yogurt was usually the favorite. And so I had yogurt all over me. And I answer the door, and there's two agents, or two women in full pantsuits, with, the rain. It was raining out, so they had the, rain suit cover. And, it was something out of, a movie. And they both held up their badges. One was an IRS agent, one was an FBI agent. And they asked to come in to ask me a few questions. And so, of course, I said, yes, of course, come on in. And I offered them coffee and water and
yogurt
off my shoulder. That was yogurt and blueberry, probably. And so I had them sit down at my dining room table, which I had to wash quickly, for them to sit down, for them to ask me questions. And the key point in how I start my book is that this is a really key moment. Because according to my lawyer, the government didn't really have a case against me until I let the agents in the door. So there is a report, I believe it's a 605 report done by the FBI, that, and it's been made famous by the Mueller investigation, as well as others, and that the FBI doesn't do any recordings of their interviews. They just take notes. So if you go into a court case, it is their interview notes against what you thought was done in that interview. And every FBI agent is decorated, of course. So a decorated FBI agent was going to be there and say, hey, this is what happened. And I'm supposed to convince a jury that that's not what happened. And so that's usually what happens. So as how I entered the book, and for everybody to know, you by law, and I didn't know this, you do not have to let them in. You actually should not let the agents in. You should say very nicely that you would love to cooperate, but you would have to talk to your lawyer and schedule a meeting with them when the lawyer is present. And that is your absolute right. I didn't know that. So I let them in, sat them down at the table. I had no idea what it was going to be about. And the only thing I could think of is at the time there was a huge FBI investigation in men's basketball. And it was about agents and so on from that. So I don't know how a sailing coach gets involved with that, but I don't know. I was grasping at straws at that point. And so I sat down, and for the first hour, it was about a 2-hour interview. It was kind of just about the admission process. You know, how does it work at Stanford? What's going on? So it's like, oh, okay, maybe they're just trying to get in more information somehow and wanted to get a sport that wouldn't be involved in something like basketball. And so they did that. Eventually, they got to the heart of the matter and started talking about Rick Singer. And so I thought, oh, wow, Rick did something bad. And that, you know, they want information on Rick. So I started talking about Rick and what I knew. And then quickly the conversation turned to the IRS agent, who in a very thick Boston accent, being from New England myself, I could recognize it very quickly, really pressed me hard and said, look, you know, you took bribes from Rick. I was like, what are you talking about? He said, well, he gave you money to have these students, to accept these students in. I was like, wait a second, but none of these students even applied to Stanford, and all the money that he donated were donations directly to Stanford. I didn't take any money. All I did was hand the checks to my bosses from this at Stanford to the development department. And I never really supported these students through admissions. I just went and asked about their grades with admissions, which I would do with tons of students. And they said, it doesn't matter. You know, this is what you are doing. And you have to admit it. And I said, I don't understand. Like, I don't understand what I did wrong or how I broke the law. I don't understand how this is a bribe if I didn't take any money. I don't get any of this. And they got really angry with me and started laying into me. And I said, look, am I in trouble? Do I need to get a lawyer? And they said, well, it'd probably be a good idea to get a lawyer, but we don't know what's going to happen. And I don't know if we're going to charge you and all these things, but you know, you should know for the future. I said, okay, so what do I do now? Well, I don't have a lawyer and a sailing coach. I don't have money for a lawyer. So they made me fill out all this paperwork, disclosing all my very depressing financials. And they again agreed that I had no money and that they should give me a public defender. And so I spent the next week trying to get a public defender and filling out all these forms to proving that I was the, you know, a poor sailing coach. And they agreed. And I got a lawyer. And then the next thing I knew, that lawyer that I'd never met before, and all this is done in Boston, calls me up and says, and I'm assuming at this point that I'm a witness against Rick Singer, that Rick Singer has done something wrong, and I'm a witness somehow for that. And I'm happy to, you know, do what I need to do. And my lawyer says, actually, no, you're not the witness. Rick Singer is the witness against you, and they're charging you with bribery. And it was unbelievable. I couldn't believe it. I just was speechless. You know, I dropped to the floor. I was like, this doesn't make any sense. I didn't take any money. And I said, well, because of actually this basketball case that I was talking about, they made a ruling that any school that has taken government funds for, you know, research or anything else, nothing to do with athletics, just government funds in general, is now a government entity. And so any money that passes hands through someone else is now considered a bribe. And I don't know how I was supposed to know that obscure law, but somehow I'm supposed to know that. And that now I could be charged with a felony crime. And it was incredibly devastating to then have to turn to my wife and tell her about all this with a 1- and 3-year-old. And that it's not even about whether I get fired or not from Stanford. It's now that I could be facing felony charges on this. And can be defended by a lawyer that I've never met before in my life, and I have no idea what he knows or how it's going to work out. And it was incredible. And furthermore, to make it even worse, is that the prosecution said, well, told my lawyer at the time that they can't talk to him for another week, and then they'll talk about charges. So I had to wait a whole week. I'm right in the middle of my season now. It's starting to kind of gear up. So I have to go to work like it's normal, like everything's normal. Go to practice every day, work with the same athletic directors every day. And I'm horrified, absolutely horrified. And I go and go about my business. I find out, you know, then about a week and a half later that now I'm going to be charged with mail fraud, tax fraud, because bribery isn't, you can't charge someone with bribery. It's just a term. You charge them with fraud and honest services fraud. Each of these fraud counts alone carries 20 years of prison. So that was really shocking. I don't know how else to put it. I just started crying. This now was not going to, forget about my career. This was now going to ruin my life. I have 1 and 3 year olds and I could go to jail for 20 plus years, for this, that I still don't understand what I did, or that if I even did anything in this. And so it really became time now for me to get my own lawyer. I did whatever I could to put money together. I have family help me out, and we paid a retainer for a lawyer from Nixon Peabody, which has a big office in San Francisco, but a really big office in Boston, and got an incredible lawyer, Robert Fisher. And he really helped me walk through it. He had expertise in these cases. He actually had written a lot of the legal theory. Same legal theory that was used for Whitey Bulger was now being used for John Vandemoer, which was just unbelievable. Being a Boston person as I am, I never thought those two things would come together. But there it is, and it's now on Wikipedia. This case was built on big names. We think at the time, too, of what the political environment was. It was about big Ivy League schools and big schools known as being the bad guys, higher education being kind of the bad guys in the new presidential administration at the time. And of course, the Justice Department works directly for the president. And it was that Yale and Georgetown and USC and Stanford, these were bad schools, with people that could think that they could do whatever they wanted. And so that was really the motivator for all of this.
So now, where is Rick Singer for those who haven't been following the news now?
So Rick Singer is here in California. He spends his time between Newport Beach and Sacramento, I believe, and is just hanging out, waiting for his sentencing. So he's been a free man for this whole time. They're keeping him a free man until he testifies or is used to testify for any of the cases that are left over. And then I'm assuming right after he testifies in that last case, then they'll sentence him. And it sounds like they're going to sentence everybody now in March, I believe, is the latest I heard.
Everybody being whom?
So there is two parents that were found guilty that went to the first trial in October. They were found guilty and they'll be sentenced in March. There is the USC athletic director, assistant athletic director, who just pled guilty 2 weeks ago, and she will be, I believe, sentenced in March as well. And there is one more coach left that's fighting it, the USC water polo coach. And I believe there's two or three parents that have a trial still that I think is set for January of next year.
Do you have any notion about how much the government spent on this sting?
Oh, it's got to be millions. Actually, to give you an idea of it, when I sat down to plea in federal court on March 12th, 2019, I sat down and my lawyer looked over at the prosecutor table and said, there's four lawyers there. It's like when we prosecuted, he was part of the prosecution for Whitey Bulger. There was two of them. They've doubled for me somehow. But there was a lot of lawyers that they put in for this. Yeah, I don't know. It's just unbelievable. The irony is unreal. But that's, they spent a lot and did a lot of research. And of course, about 6 months worth of wiretaps as well, which really did that. Because that's how they got Rick originally, through a guy named Rudy Meredith, who is the soccer coach at Yale. He was the original guy that was busted and he ended up giving up Rick Singer, and then Rick Singer gave up everybody else.
So now how many checks did you physically in your hand receive?
A total of three that were each sent to my mailbox at the athletic department and came in the mail, and I handed them over to development. The last check, which was the FBI was listening to my phone calls with Rick at the end, and was probably wrote the check. They wrote the check not only to Stanford, but they wrote the check to me as well. They really wanted me to cash the check myself because then I would be taking personal money and they would make their, you know, their case a lot easier. But I didn't even open the envelope. I just handed the envelope. I didn't even know my name was on the check until right before my sentencing, actually. After the probation showed me the check. Otherwise, I had no idea.
So the first $500,000 check, that actually came from the family that was trying to influence the deal.
Yeah.
And how did these second checks not come from those families, but come one of them from the FBI?
So the third check came out of a phone call that the FBI was listening to. And Rick had said on there that he wanted to make a deposit on our relationship. So I was thinking back to our previous conversation with the $110,000 that he believed in me. And so I was assuming that it was the same type of deposit on our relationship. It's kind of a weird way of saying it. I get it. But Rick was a weird guy. And so I said, oh, great. And so it was another $100,000 that he wanted to donate from his foundation. And he wanted to keep bringing me students to look at. And I said, great. You know, happy to look at students. I mean, the more students across my desk, the better. So that was fantastic. So I assume that he is now a donor and now my biggest donor I've ever had, and also a recruiter at the same time. So I thought that was the best thing to do. Apparently in that check, he wrote it to Stanford / John Vandemoer. But I never even saw that until after the case was open.
So now were they part of the, you said the FBI was on the call when he was talking to you. This because he was setting you up? Is that what was going on here?
Yes, that phone call was a complete setup. So he had, my lawyer described to me, because that's what he would do when he was a prosecutor, is he set up a full script, and that Rick is reading from that script. He was in Boston. He actually said on the phone call that he was in Boston. So he's probably in the federal building calling me. And he's kind of walking me through the whole relationship. The hard part for me, and what really comes down to me not having evidence to defend myself, is that he breaks down this whole relationship in this phone call in a very quick timeline when I was in my office. So as incredible as Stanford is in technology, there is no cell phone reception in the athletic department. It's the concrete walls. I don't know what happens. Also, when the spin cycle happens for the football team, for the washers down below, it shakes the whole building like there's an earthquake. It is unbelievable that we can't solve those two things, cell phone reception and not shake everybody's offices. I've had recruits' parents dive under the desk thinking that it was an earthquake. It's like, no, we're just in the spin cycle of six washing machines right below us. It's incredible. And every coach there will tell you these two things. It's just insane. But there was no cell phone. So what I had to do is he called me at my desk. I was meeting with Clinton at Bell at the time. He called me. He had set up the phone call.
Meaning you were meeting with your coaches.
It was meeting with the coaches. Yeah. We were doing kind of a weekly meeting going through the week ahead. And he had set up the phone call that he was going to call me and talk about another donation, you know, the deposit on our relationship. And so I knew it was coming. I was like, oh, excuse me, I got to go out and take this phone call. So I have to go on my office on the second floor. So I have to go out of my office, go down to the other end of the hallway, through another door, down two stairs to another landing, go through another door, down the hallway and out the door. And then finally, I've got cell phone reception. And so he's calling and talking really fast. And this whole time that I'm running down here, and even in the transcript that I saw later has me panting in the transcript because I'm walking down these flights of stairs. And I get outside, and I've never heard I've only read some of the transcript, whatever the government releases, but my lawyer had heard some of the tape, and he's like, John, it's unbelievable. It's clear that you are not listening at all. It's clear that you're completely out of breath because you're running downstairs, and he's quickly talking you through all this stuff, and you're just yaying him to death. So I'm sitting there, it's everything he says, I'm like, yeah, 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 right, sounds good, yep, yep. And the whole time that he's saying, oh, you know, Molly Zhao was not a sailor, you know, you knew that, right? Yep. Oh, you know, this student, you know, we had this deal that I was going to donate $500,000. You know, you think that's true, right? Yep. And it just went on to these three students. And by the time I got outside, it's then the part of the conversation where he's saying, well, you know, I want to make a deposit, you know, on our relationship. And I want to donate the $100,000. And he actually has me do math to figure out it's going to be $100,000. And this is part of the FBI setup to have me go through the numbers to prove that I know what's going on. I get the math wrong because I'm not paying attention. And it's like easy math, like 1 minus 2, you know, like, you know, 2 plus 1. And I get it wrong. And he's laughing at me on the phone. And it's just, yeah, it's just incredible. So that's the whole phone call. And at the end of it, I'm like, oh, great. You know, he's donated $100,000, whatever it was. You know, this is great. And I went and told my, you know, my bosses at the time and said, hey, Rick wants to donate again and so on. They said, great. Here's where the funds you can donate it to. And the check came. I didn't even open up the check. I just brought it down to the first floor to development and did that. And now somehow I'm a felon for the rest of my life.
What's going on with your sentencing and all that?
Yeah, so I was sentenced in on June 12th of 2019. I was the first person sentenced in the case, which was, I was told by my lawyer, was a good thing to do. I decided to take the information or the plea deal that they were offering me, which they offered me 18 months in jail and pleading guilty to conspiracy racketeering, which is the lesser of the felonies. And you know, they agreed not to go hard on me in sentencing. Unfortunately, between that agreement and my sentencing, something else incredible happened. Probably the first time in history that the prosecution broke my plea deal. Usually the defendant breaks plea deals all the time, but the prosecution broke it this time because they had realized that they made a mistake. And that it wasn't, I don't think they really cared as much about me, but it was going to impact all the deals they had already done with all the parents that were pleading guilty. And so instead of taking it easy on me, they were going to push hard. And so they decided to lower the months that they were asking for to 13 months, which is very generous of them. And then they wanted to change my sentencing guidelines. So it made it more likely that the judge was going to give me jail time. It's a conspiracy case. It's a racketeering case. And so in racketeering, all the sentencing guidelines are stricter. And so there's more penalties. So you get points. You get rated points for how many things you did wrong, essentially. And the more points you get, the more chance you get for years in prison or months in prison. And so they wanted to change that so that it would kind of raise the floor. So the judge would have to give me something. They ran into a big problem, though, because this is a fraud case. And fraud is totally built on whether there's a loss, a financial loss. And in this case, there's zero financial loss because I didn't take any money. And everybody agrees to that. The government agreed to it. Stanford, in their victim impact report, said that they didn't take, you know, I didn't take any money as well. And so the judge in my case went to the prosecution and said, this is probably the first fraud case in history that the defendant gave all the money to the victim. And they agreed that that was odd, but that I should still be, you know, prosecuted for this.
The defendant gave all the money to the victim.
Yes, it's the first time in history that that's happened.
How was Stanford the victim in their model of this?
Because they charged me with conspiracy racketeering, which basically comes up to honest services fraud. So basically, I didn't do my job, and so I have failed Stanford, even though they made $710,000 from this. So
what happened when he pointed out that this is the first time he knew of where the defendant gave the money to the victim?
The prosecution got very upset and started yelling. There was lots of yelling. It was a very emotionally charged case. My sentencing that was supposed to take, 10 minutes took, you know, well over an hour. it was really complicated. It started off with, this is an unbelievable moment where we go in, you stand up for the judge as the judge enters, and she enters. And this right before we sit down, she calls us all to her bench, right out of a movie. Everybody, the prosecution and defendants, please come to the bench. Come to the bench, and she pulls out and has the bailiff there hand us all a paper. And the paper is an email from someone that had emailed the judge on their personal email, which is a huge issue, and threatened the judge and said that the judge better give me jail time or that she's in real trouble. So that was certainly the first telltale sign that this was emotionally charged and threatened the judge's life. That if they, if I didn't get prosecuted to the nth degree, that they were kind of come after her. So she had said that, she was not biased by this. This wasn't going to change her decision on me. And that was okay. And she had referred all this to the marshal service. So the marshals were going to investigate it. Through this case, my life was threatened a few times. The judge's life was threatened. It just was incredible how disgusting this got for people. And for people that didn't really understand the facts of the case. And for a media that wasn't really letting up the facts of the case either. In the end, I was sentenced to a $10,000 fine, 2 years probation with the first 6 months in home monitoring. So I was under house arrest. So I wore an ankle bracelet for 6 months. I was on probation, which I finished in June of this year. So I'm all done with that. And I paid my $10,000 fine with my retirement fund from Stanford. So that was, I'm all done with all of that. Moving forward.
You've gone through an incredible adventure and you wrote a book about it. Talk about the writing process.
So I started off writing the book as just wanting to tell my story. My friends and family had reached out and said, look, we want you to tell your story because your story deserves to be told. And we want just at least for us, and I never wrote this book to change anybody's mind. I just wanted to tell my story. But in the end, what really happened was going through the writing process was the best thing I could have ever done. It changed my life. It really did. I really looked back at a lot of things that I had done, not just with this case, but who I was as a coach and as a person, as a husband, as a father, and really took time to, almost a year to go through it and really dissect my life. And really allow myself to be vulnerable. And I believe in this book, I'm extremely vulnerable, extremely open and honest about who I was and who I want to be and who I thought I was. And it was a really tough, tough process with lots of, I would go out and talk on my headset on my phone and walk on the beach in the morning. I'd get up at 5 a.m. before work and go and walk on the beach and just dictate stuff through my phone. And the whole time I was crying. And so I'm sure other joggers and walkers walking by, like, what is going on with this guy? what's happening with it? But it was a really a cathartic process that helped me heal, especially during COVID, where I was getting therapy before that. And then online therapy didn't really work for me. But the book became my therapy. And the person I was working with the book became my therapist. And it was really helpful to not only put ideas about how to structure the book and write it and so on, but to really talk through my life and my situations. And it became amazing for me. And it's helped me a lot through my relationship with my family. So this is my book, Rigged Justice. It's a short book, as you can see, but it was a real, a year of my life of really pouring into this and a lot of emotion, a lot of soul searching in this book. And it also highlights some great heroes that helped me along in this really tough journey. So wow. Please take a look at it.
Yeah, amazing. Terrific. And so it can be purchased. Is it in bookstores? Where is it now?
It's in bookstores everywhere. It's on Amazon, of course, as well. You can also find it near you through the HarperCollins website. They have a kind of a book search there.
John, thank you very much for sharing your story with the Wednesday Yachting Luncheon. as a guy who knows you and knows your lovely wife, Molly, and has been at your house, I can say you're an incredible credit to Stanford as an organization. I'm so sorry that a buddy was subjected to such an incredibly horrible and grueling experience. But on the other side of it, I look forward to people reading your book, learning about what I already know, which is that you're such a good, solid citizen, and look forward to seeing you out in sailboats, because don't forget, we still have the world of sailing to enjoy as well.
Well, thank you so much for having me, and thank you so much for listening to my story.
We all know it's kind of hard to unring a bell. You took a plea. Your name was, you know, all over this scandal. You know, certainly not, you know, like Lori Loughlin's and, you know, people who were famous like that, but certainly people know your name because of this. Do you think there will be a time where anybody looks at you and says, oh, that was the guy who was involved in that. He took a plea. He's obviously guilty. And you say you're not guilty. You took the plea. Do you think that stays with you, that label stays with you for the rest of your life?
It does. I mean, there's no way around it. I mean, if you look on Wikipedia or anything else about the case, my name is listed there with everybody else. But that's not really what I'm concerned with. I really wanted to tell my story out there so my family, the people that know me, my friends, more importantly, my kids, I have a 5 and 3-year-old, so they can hear my story from my words. And that's really what matters.
All right. And there it is. John Vandemoer, thank you so much. Rigged Justice, How the College Admissions Scandal Ruined an Innocent Man's Life, is available wherever books are sold.
This has been a presentation of the Wednesday Yachting Luncheon.